एंड सिमरजीत सिंह, आर यू देयर?
यस सर, आई एम हियर सर।
प्लीज
ओके सर,
पार्टिसिपेशन
थैंक
ऑफ
यू।
योर कास्ट इन मनरेगा जॉब एंड इंटर रीजनल एनालिसिस, काइंडली स्टार्ट विद द प्रेजेंटेशन। आई एम डॉक्टर चेयर, डॉक्टर तमान इज नॉट देयर, सो आई एम टेकिंग हिज ड्यूटी, सो काइंडली स्टार्ट विद द प्रेजेंटेशन एंड शेयर द स्क्रीन आल्सो।
ओके सर, थैंक यू। Is it visible?
Visible, it's visible. Start from the beginning.
Okay, sir. Okay. So, good morning to all of you. Myself, Shubham Singh. I have jointly prepared this paper with Simarjit Singh. We are the research scholars in the Department of Economics, Punjab University, Patiala. So, the title of our paper is the participation of scheduled castes in MEN rakes in Punjab. It is an inter-regional analysis. So this is the basic introduction about the scheme and what is the situation of employment in India. As employment is on the development agenda in India since the initiation of planning in the country, but the employment situation has not been quite impressive because about 94% of the workforce is engaged in the informal sector. Unemployment and the disguised unemployment are the normal features of Indian economy. Over the years, various development policies and schemes have been introduced for the upliftment of the weaker sections in the country. But it is the fact that the poor, disadvantaged and the marginal sections, that are mainly the scheduled castes and scheduled tribes, do not get proper facilities and they have been discriminated in the matter of participation. Hello. हेलो,
हेलो
सर, इज इट विजिबल?
यस प्लीज गो अहेड।
हेलो,
वी कैन लिसन टू यू। या यू आर ऑडिबल नाउ?
ओके ओके,
सो कम, योर प्रेजेंटेशन इज ओवर और यू आर?
नो नो, आई एम स्टार्टिंग इट।
हेलो
हेलो,
या इट्स ऑडिबल
नाउ। ओके ओके, थैंक यू। सो द एमएन रेक्स दैट वाज स्टार्टेड इन 2005 एंड लेटर नेम्ड एज द मनरेगा, दिस इज ऑल अबाउट दिस, बट आई एम कमिंग डायरेक्टली कमिंग टू द पॉइंट। वन ऑफ द स्ट्रॉन्गेस्ट आर्ग्यूमेंट फॉर द मनरेगा इज दैट इट्स प्राइमरी बेनिफिशरीज आर फ्रॉम द मार्जिनलाइज्ड एंड द डिसएडवांटेज कम्युनिटीज एंड इट बेनिफिट्स not only as wage earners but also in many other ways, such as an entry point for their active participation in gram sabhas and other institutions of the local governance. So some empirical studies conducted in Punjab states pointed out that majority of beneficiaries belong to scheduled caste category, but this
during
100 days of employment because of various socio economic and political reasons. According to the census of 2011, the SC population was 16.63% of total population in India, whereas in Punjab this share was about 32%. it is clear that the the Punjab has the highest percentage share of the SC population among all states of the country. Secondly, when we see the operational land holdings of the state, the SC households have only 6.02% of the land holdings. The majority of are either landless or have having an economic size of the land holdings. So the Narega can be the sustainable source of development, source of livelihood for these poor households. Therefore, in this present paper, an attempt has been made to analyze the participation of the scheduled castes households in Manrega, in Majha, Malwa, and Doaba regions of the Punjab. The objectives of the primary study were, first was the to study the number of households having job cards under the Manrega. Second, to analyze the number of households provided employment under Manrega. Third one, to examine the number of work days generated under Manrega in Punjab. So the last objective was to work out the number of households provided 100 days of employment and the average days of employment generated under Manrega in Punjab. So methodology, this study is based on the secondary data sources collected from various reports, journals, books, articles and websites, etc. The SC, for the analysis of the SC participation in this scheme, the data was taken from the website of the Ministry of Rural Development, New Delhi. This was 2014. So the results and the first one table, it is about the number of households with job card under Manrega in Punjab. Overall, in 2014-15, when we go to the percentage share in Majha region, in 2014-15, about 68.65% households were from the scheduled caste category. But in the 2018-19, there has been declined to the 0.28%. Secondly, the Malwa region. In Malwa region, this year was 77.20%. Again, this is declined to about the 73%. But in Doaba region, there is a very slightly increase. This year increased from 69% to 70%. But this is very marginal increase. When we see the overall picture of the Punjab state, then it clearly shows that overall Punjab, the number of households with job cards and under Manrega were 74.55% in 2014-15. But in 2018-19, this year declined to 69.86%. Means there is a 5% decline, 5% decline in the job cards of the scheduled caste category households. The second table, it is about the number of households provided employment. When we see the number of households provided employment, then it is clear that in the... Hello, sir. Hello, am I audible? Yes, please. Am I audible?
Yes, please carry on.
Okay, it is a request to the organizers. Please, all other participants. Please mute to the other participants.
हाँ देखिए आज आवाज नहीं आ रही.
Okay, I am presenting. In Majha region, the number of households provided employment, it was 51% share of the scheduled caste households in 2014-15. And it declined to 50% in the 18-19. In Malwa region, that is the largest region of Punjab with the 14 districts, this year was about 82%, but in 2018-19 it declined to the 77%, means there is 5% decline in the households, SC households. So in Doaba region, it increased from 72% to the 76%. But overall picture of the Punjab state shows that the number of households provided employment in the, under MG Nareks was the 79% of the scheduled caste categories in 2014-15. But in 2018-19, it declined to the about 74%. Means here also there is decline about the 5% of the scheduled caste category households. The third one is, that is a more important table. This is a number of percentage generated and the relative share of the scheduled caste category households. In Majha region, the share was the 37%. In the 2014-15, but when we see the in 2018-19, this share increased to about the 50%. Okay, but in Malwa region, that is the same region here, is that this is the largest region with the 14 districts. In 2014-15, this share was the 81% in the Malwa region, but again, when we see the picture of the last year, 2018-19, this year declined to the 77.61%. Similarly, in Doaba region, it slightly, very slightly increased from the 73% to 74%. But overall, the picture of the Punjab state shows that in 2014-15, the share of scheduled caste households in the total number of percentage generated was the 76.72%. But in 2018-19, it declined to the 73.36%. Means there is that decline about the 4% in the number of percentage generated of the scheduled caste category households. This is about the number of households provided 100 days of employment. In 2014-15, only 336 in the Majha region were provided 100 days of employment. So the table clearly shows that the best provided employment. Okay, so I am skipping this table. So this is more important. Percentage of households provided 100 days of employment.
Yeah.
So in 2014-15, overall in Majha region, 1.8% of the households provided 100 days of employment. But the share of the SC households was only about the 0.47%. 18-19, this year declined to 0.83%. The trend in the Majha region. But when we picture of the Punjab, it shows that 2019, about the one households that were provided employment, means out of the 100 households, only one household was provided days of employment. But in the scheduled caste household, divided of these households provided the 100 days of employment. So the last table is about the average number of percentage generated. So when we see the average number of percentage, this is very interesting table, because if we see the region-wise analysis, the region-wise analysis shows that in the Majha region, that when we see the total household average number of the percentage generated for the total households in 2014-19, for the total households, the average number were the 27.47. But for the scheduled caste category households, these were only about the 20 days of the days of the work. Okay. In 2018-19, similarly, although the average number of percentage increased for the total as well as the scheduled caste category households, but the overall they are less from the total households. Similarly, in the Malwa region and the Doaba region, these are the given here. Overall, in Punjab, in 2014-15, for the total households, the average number of person days were generated that were the 22.3 work days. And for the dual caste category households, these were the 21.7%. In the current year, that is the last year, 2018-19, for the total households, the average number were provided, the average number of work days were provided 30.29%. But for the scheduled caste category household, these were the 30.03%. So the conclusions of the study shows that the percentage share of the scheduled caste households in the total number of households with job cards, as well as in the number of households provided employment, showed a declining trend over the yes. Secondly, the share of the scheduled caste households in total number of percentage generated under the was also declining. Among scheduled caste category households, the percentage share of the households who received the 100 days of employment, as well as the average number of days of employment generated, was also lower in Punjab. The performance of emission rates is not satisfactory across the Malwa, Malwa and Doaba regions, because households have provided hundreds of employment. Various studies have found that the poor awareness, irregularities in the issue of job cards, low wages, non-provision of work despite the demand for the same, and the non-payment or the irregular payment of the wages have contributed to the exit of the SC households from the MGNREGA. To increase the participation of the SC households, these households should be involved in the Gram Sabha so that their needs can be taken into the consideration. They should provide more employment opportunities, because these households are labor dependent and are willing to undertake the manual labor work. The process of social audit, that is the main feature of the act, it also should be strengthened. As the GND pointed out, that the real challenge in India is not the enactment of the NREGA, but its implementation on the ground. Therefore, the center and state governments must implement this scheme in its real meaning, so that its objective to transform and develop the rural economy in general and to uplift the marginalized sections of the society in particular can be achieved. So thank you. This was all about my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Sukram Singh. Any question, please, from the participants? Unmute and you can ask question if there is some question. Any question, please? Any clarification on the presentation? So, from I have one clarification.
Yes, sir.
What do you suggest to make this program successful? What are your main suggestion?
Program is the very well program, but the problem is in its enactment at the ground level. When we see in a reality, I also lives in the village. There are the dummy presence of the persons at the village level. The sponsors and the members are presenting the presence of the person that are not really in the. Really don't work. Therefore, the implementation is limitation of the implementation is on the ground level. So the social audit process must be strengthened. There is the urgent and the dire need of the social audit.
Thank you very much. Any question from the participants, please? Unmute and you can ask a question if you have some clarification you have any. Dr. Pavinder Kaur, you can ask something. Ravjit Kaur.
Sir, my one addition is also here that the limitation of my paper is that one study I have seen the by the Jayati Ghosh. They have taken the scheduled caste participation of the various states. They have taken that what percentage of the population of the SC population in the state, and what is the relative share and the compare. What is the relative share in the state in the MGNREGA district-wise scheduled caste participation. So the district-wise SC participation can be compared with the that district's participation in the MGNREGA. So this is the limitation and can be added to this paper.
Do you find any person from the general category also participate in this scheme?
Yes, sir. I have shown that the percentage. Share of the SC relative share of household, but in I think that due to the practices, general caste households are not in the share is not easy in.
But when you're comparing the participation of scheduled caste. People with that of the general category. What you think is responsible? What main factors are there which are making a distinction very, very, is highlighting the distinction that why there is, less participation or they are less employed, the SC category workers? I mean, is there any kind of, discrimination has been particularly related to these first in terms of giving them the work or what? Can you explain it to you?
Ma'am, please repeat briefly. I think there is some network
problem. Whether there is a discrimination happening in terms of caste?
Yes, 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 I got it. So I have shown that the percentage share of the SC households have declined.
Yes.
It declined in the terms of the number of job cards, as well as the number of households provided employment, secondly.
Yes.
Thirdly, it also shows that the SC households provided employment are less in percentage compared to the counterparts that are the general category households. So these are my broader findings.
I'm basically
why?
Findings.
So the why? Yes, 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 why? I have already told that the one reason for the SC households to exit from this is that the relative wage rate is very less. As you see, the wage rate of the SC of the MGNREGA is currently 241.
Mm.
But the market wage rate is not 241. They are preferring the market wage rate. Okay, so this
why
is the one
SC
point.
SC category
Secondly, I have said that the one region that is very difficult to find, but it may be, I am not sure, it may be that there is the malpractices, that is the corruption at the village level. Corruption at the, generally when the sarpanch is from the general category, so they are the dummy cards, okay, means they are not actually working. The general category households not actually working, but they are shown as the present at the work. So this is also the this is the general category households participation, because yes.
Okay, thank you.
Ma'am.
Hello. Any more question, please? Hello. Bandh ho gaya. Hello. Any more question, please? If no more question, then I invite the paper number 92. The writers are Prabhjot Kaur, Pankaj Kumar, Jasveer Singh Gill, Paramveer Singh and Jagvinder Singh. And the article is popularization of chicken pea and canola sarso for sustainable agriculture in Punjab. Who's going to present, please? Tell your name, please. Are you there?
Yes, yes.
Who will present?
Mr. Jagvinder Singh will present.
Okay, okay. Kindly start with the presentation. Unmute and start presentation, please. Sound is not coming.
Good morning. Myself Jagvinder Singh, I'm presenting on popularization of chickpea and canola sarso for sustainable agriculture in Punjab. The food security, here all the people physically collect food. Although wheat and paddy is abundant, but there is shortage of pulses, vegetable, oil seeds. Low return from the pulses and oil seeds as compared to paddy and wheat crop rotation. Chickpea and mustard crops having numerous, but these have not much adopted by the farmers on a large scale. With the concept of popularization of the chickpea and mustard among the farmers, frontline demonstrations were conducted under Farmer First program. Methodology: in Rabi season 2017 and 2018, 50 demonstrations of chickpea and 70 demonstrations of canola sarso over plot size of 0.4 hectare each were conducted every year. Benchmark survey and sampling of tillage was done. Consequently, potential farmers were identified. Training on package of practices of cultivation of chickpea and canola sarso was provided by the scientists of PAU Ludhiana. Seed of the improved varieties PBG7, chickpea GSC7, canola sarso was supplied to the farmers free of cost as critical input. Data were collected from the FLDs and from the farmers' field to compare different parameters. The observations were recorded at various stages of the crops and yield data were recorded for both research and local plots. Cost of cultivation, net income, cost benefit ratio were worked out. Results and discussions. Comparison between demonstrated technology package and farmers' practices in chickpea. The demonstrated field, the farming was the irrigated and sandy loam soils with medium nitrogen, high phosphorus and high potassium. While on farmers' field, it was irrigated. Same were the farming situations. And the variety on the demonstrated field was PBG7, while there was a local variety on farmers' field. The seed rate of the PBG7 was 37.5 to 45 kg per hectare, while that on farmers' field was 40 to 45 kg per hectare. The sowing time of the PBG7 was 10 October to 25 October, while that of farmers' field was 15 October to 30 October. Seed treatment was done on the PBG7 seed while it was absent on the farmer's field practice. Method of sowing row-to-row distance 30 cm with seed in demonstrated plot, while row-to-row distance of same was that there in the farmer's field. Fertilizer was as recommended, whilst weed management stump 30 EC at the rate of 1 liter per acre was done on the demonstrated field. Pest management, need-based sprays were done for the pest management on both the plots. The yield performance of the demonstrated plots of chickpea. The year 2017 and 18, the total number of 50 FLDs were there and 0.4 hectare area of each and the yield per hectare was potential was 20, while demonstrated plot was 17 quintal per hectare, and the control plot was 16. While that in 18-19, the yield was 17.1 on demonstrated plot and 15.5 on the control. Economic analysis of the FLD on chickpea. In 2000, the total cost on the demonstration plot was 10,180, while that of yield was 17 quintal per hectare. Gross returns were 74,413, while that of the local check, the gross returns were 70,928. And the BC ratio of the demonstrated plot was 2.35, and that of local check was 2.10. While in 2018-19, the BC ratio of the demonstrated plot was 1.99 and the local check was 1.47. Comparison between demonstrated technology package and farmers' practices in canola sarson. Farming situation was same on the demonstrated field as well as the farmer field. Variety was GSC7. In farmer field, it was a local variety. Seed rate was 3.75 kg per hectare on demonstrated plot and 3 to 4.5 kg per hectare on farmer's field. Sowing time was 10 October to 30 October on the demonstrated plot and 10 to first week of the November on the farmer's field. Method of sowing, row to row distance of 45 cm with seed drill, while broadcasting or seed drill was done on the farmer's field. Yield performance of the demonstrated plots of canola sarson. In 2017-18, total number of 17 FLDs were organized and the potential yield was 22.25, while that of demonstrated plot was 2.06 and control plot was 19.78. Okay. Technology gap quintal per hectare was 0.28 and extension gap was 2.19. While that on in year 2018-19, total 17 demonstrations were there and the demonstrated plot yield was 20 quintal per hectare, control plot in quintal per hectare, technology total year extension, economic assessment. The plot was 18,700 per hectare and existing farmer practices in case of chickpea and canola sarson. Adoption of the recommendations resulted in more yield. More important was the farmer that the time to turn from wheat. Rationalization of the FLDs was not to give them more returns than existing farmers' practices, but also to reintroduce cultivation of these crops. If we compare with wheat, the returns may be a bit less, but more important is that these crops are required for nutritional security and diversification. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jagvinder. Any question from the participants, please? Any clarification? Kindly unmute your mic, then speak, please. Any question, please, any clarification on this presentation? Sukram, can you tell me how much area been cultivated under these crops in Punjab? Do you hear me? Hello, Jagvinder.
Hello. Answer.
How much area is put to these crops in Punjab?
It's about 30,000, sir. 30,000 hectares.
The district is sown, this crop is sown in which district?
It's in Sangrur district.
This area is, I think, on the higher side. Kindly check with the data. And why the farmer now adopting the package practice of PAU for these crops? If there is some gap, why they are now adopting this? Hello.
Actually, sir, they are more interested in the traditional methods we are using since years. While in
it means that our extension agencies are now working well with these farmers. Otherwise, they could have adopted the package practice according
actually,
to.
Actually, sir, we have reintroduce the crops. They were usually sowing wheat and paddy.
Hello, continue please. Hello, are you there?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Any more question, please, from the audience, from the participants? If there is no question, I must thank Jagvinder for a nice presentation. Now I invite the next.
Sir,
I now invite the next presenter. It's Devinder Singh or Prabhjot Kaur. The title of the article: Source Conservation Technology in Punjab, Status and Problems. Who will be going to present this paper, please?
Yes, sir. Good morning, sir. I'm going to present.
Devinder Singh.
Yes, sir.
Kindly continue.
Okay, sir. Wait.
Share your screen and continue.
Okay, sir. Sir, is it visible?
Well, please start with the presentation.
Okay, sir. Good morning to all. I am Devinder Singh. Today I am going to present my review paper on resource conservation technologies in Punjab, its status and problems. Resource conservation technologies, or simply RCTs, they refers to practices or technologies that enhance resources by minimal tillage, ensuring soil nutrients and growth of cover, adoption of substantial temporal crops. The moderators of these RCTs, attitude of farmer problems selected are for the presented the root green laser leveler and status question on use of RCTs, area under RCTs, economic benefit on use of RCTs and attitude of farmers towards this coming to results. Important complex innovation is first exposed to the social system through different communication channels. In majority of the studies, reviewed major source of information of less regarding happy seeder and zero till drill was mainly disseminated through PAU and fellow farmers. Training is an important aspect for the different farm activities, new venture to start on the farmer's field. It helps farmer to adopt recommended practices in a better way. It was observed that very small proportion of farmers had attended any kind of training on these selected RCTs. Area under technology is one of the indicator to observe the status of technology. More the area under any technology, we consider it its status is better. Farmers practice green manuring on about half of their cultivable land on their farm. From majority of the studies, it was also reviewed that farmers used happy seeder on about 57% of their total operation and holding on an average. Lesser leveler was used on about 83% of the total operation land of the farmers. So the adoption of or status of lesser land leveler is far better than other similar or other resource conservation technologies. Whereas 65% of the land was covered under zero-till drill. So zero-till drill is the second mostly used resource conservation technology in Punjab after land leveler. Now coming to average expenditure incurred on different RCTs. There are two types of rents prevailing in Punjab condition on renting of farm machinery. One is per hectare basis, and second is per hour basis. Further, these rents were also classified into two categories, including tractor and without tractor. On an average, from the studies reviewed, it was found that per hectare rent of happy seeder, including tractor, was 3,193 rupees. While on per hour basis, the rent of happy seeder was around 800 with tractor. Average rent of lesser landler leveler with a tractor was 2,468 rupees per hectare. While without tractor, it was about 750 rupees per hectare. On per hour basis, rent of land leveler without with tractor, it was 775 rupees, and without tractor, it was 100 rupees. Per hectare charge of zero till drill including tractor was rupees 1500, about 1500, and without tractor it was 750 rupees per hectare. Average rent of zero till drill without tractor on per hour basis was 217 rupees. So economic benefits on the use of RCTs. Economic benefits were operationalized in terms of change in yield, expenditure on input use, change in income as an outcome of use of these RCTs. Studies claimed that an increase in wheat yield range from 4 to 16% with adoption of zero-till drill. Increase in yield in wheat crop were also observed ranging from 3 to 10%. In case of lesser land leveler. Regarding happy seeder, majority of the farmers observed an increase in yield of wheat crop, while contrary to this, some studies observed a decrease in yield after using happy seeder. That is up to 12%. Green manuring crop and lesser leveler increase the cost of cultivation. Happy seeder technology saves input cost between 2000 to 4000 as compared to conventional seed drill. There was one study reported an increase in expenditure on adoption of happy seeder. So expenditure was increased after using happy seeder in that one study. Majority of the studies reported the cost was less in case of zero till drill. Thank you. economic benefit on the basis of income generation by the use of different RCTs. So it was observed from the majority of the studies with the adoption of green manuring, low income was reported because expenditure is more in case of green manuring. In majority of the studies reviewed, an increase in net income was observed after using heavy seeder in Punjab. But contrary to this, decrease in income was also observed in some studies. This was due to extra expenditure while using heavy seeder on their farm. So, zero till drill showed an increase in net income of the farmer. Now coming to attitude of farmers toward different RCT, majority of the farmers, they expressed favorable attitude for green manuring due to its easy cultivation. Proportion of farmers expressed strongly unfavorable attitude toward heavy seeder technology due to its high cost, rent, and yield loss in wheat crop. Yield loss is not for all observed in all the studies. It was only in some of the studies. Laser leveler and zero till drill accepted and adopted by the farmers of Punjab. Adoption of any new technology might accompany certain problems. Beside these problems, some farmers still continue with the adoption of technology, but there were others who discontinue the technology. Review of these problems can help the extension workers and government agencies to find way to overcome these problems for the sustained adoption of technology. So these are the some problems highlighted in reviewed studies. In case of green manuring, late availability of seed of green manure crop is the major problem faced by almost all the farmers. High cost of seed is the second one. Its residue take time to decompose. Weed problem in green manuring fields. Excessive growth of green manuring crop affect functioning of farm machineries. Increased cost of seed, field work, necessary for preparing the seed bed, incorporation, and possibly for moving. So all the expenditures may increase in case of green manuring. So it is a problem for some of the farmers. Direct loss of income due to high cost in expenditures. Second one is laser leveler. The major problem faced by the farmer in laser leveler is lack of training regarding functioning of laser leveler. Then high cost is one of the major problem in case of laser leveler.
Wind off.
Okay, sir. So it can be concluded from the study reviewed regarding these RCTs that some technologies are still under early stage of its adoption. Use of zero till drill and heavy seeder shows an increase in income, economic benefit due to reduction in cost of cultivation as reported by most of the studies. Similarly, all the RCTs help to increase crop yield. Majority of the farmers have a favorable attitude toward all these RCTs, but adoption of these RCTs is still low due to the number of factors. The main factors, they are non-availability of these machineries, high cost, lack of training, and lack of coordination among various stakeholders. There were many constraints faced by the farmer in adoption of various RCTs. Non-availability of inputs is a common problem faced by the farmers for all the RCTs. Few studies reported the negative prospects of RCTs as the technology still need functional improvement at farmers level. So this was all about my presentation. Thanks to all.
Very much, Rinder Singh ji. Any question, please? Any point you want to clarify from Rinder Singh? Anybody who want to ask something? Rinder, what is the role of PAU in promoting these technology at the farmer level? Have you studied that the role, what role they are playing? Hello, Rinder? Hello? Devinder, do you hear me? Hello.
Devinder ji. Devinder ji. Please, if any more question on this presentation, please, any query, anything more you want to add?
Good morning to everyone. I am Rapri Singh and I am presenting my paper, topic economic benefits of protected vegetable cultivation by the... Hello?
Please continue.
You're audible. Lovely, Lovepreet, you're audible. Please continue.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you. Economic benefits of the protected vegetable cultivation by the farmer trained by KVK Jalandhar. Introduction. Protected cultivation defined as the modification of microclimate of the plant fully or partially as per the need of the plant spaces during the growing period. The study was conducted to evaluate economic benefits derived from protected vegetable cultivation by the farmer trained by KVK Jalandhar. Methodology. The study was conducted in Jalandhar district of Punjab. A list of farmers who were trained in the phase of 2013-17 was collected from the KVK Jalandhar and a total 150 respondents were selected according to PPS sampling and 50 respondents were taken without training as non-trainee. 20 non-sample farmers were selected for pre-testing of interview schedule. The response of the respondents were analyzed with the help of appropriate tools such as frequency, percentage, mean score, and range methods. Now results. Firstly, the distribution of respondents according to socio-personal characteristic. Age. 42% of the trainees and 38% of the non-trainees had the age between 39 to 52 years old and the education level. Uh, 19.3% of trainees at the graduate level and 20% of non-trainees at the middle level education level. Then operational land holding. A majority of the trainees and non-trainees at the medium level of operational land holding. Then family type. 63.3% of the trainees at the nuclear type family and more than half of the non-trainees at the joint type family. And the 63.3% has the up to 5 members in trainees and more than half of the non-trainees having more than 5 family size. Majority of trainees and non-trainees have the farming as occupation. Then distribution of the respondent according to mass media exposure. Among trainees, then firstly farm broadcast. Kheti Badi ranked first in trainees among farm broadcast. But in non-trainees, Dihati program ranked first. In farm telecast, Sona Punjab ranked first among both in trainees and non-trainees. Then in print media, Modern Kheti ranked first among trainees, but in non-trainees, Changi Kheti ranked first. Then in social media, WhatsApp ranked first both in trainees and non-trainees. Then distribution of respondent according to the source of information. HD, that is Horticulture Development Officer, ranked first among trainees and non-trainees for regarding the source of information. Then yield of the different crops under different protected cultivation of vegetables. Trainees had the more yield as compared to non-trainees in all crops in polyhouse followed by net house and the low tunnel structure. And similarly, in net profit of different crops, trainees fetch the more profit in all crops in polyhouse followed by net house and then low tunnel. Conclusion. Protected vegetable cultivation is a suitable technology for Punjab to increase the net income and can play a positive role in nutritional security by making vegetable available in off season. It is concluded that training play an important role in fetching high yield and profit of selected vegetable crops under protected cultivation. as compared to non-trainees. So farmers should be encouraged to training before starting protected vegetable cultivation. Thank you.
Any question from the participant, please? Any reaction, any contribution, anything you want to contribute?
Preet, can I ask you a question?
Yes, ma'am. Cultivation of vegetables in a microclimate, which is we can modify their temperature, humidity, okay, in a protect like poly house, net
house. You say cultivation in the controlled environment.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Any more question, please? Lovepreet, what is the role of PAU in promoting protected vegetable cultivation? Do you find any role of PAU? Hello?
Sorry, sir. Hello?
Do you find any role of PAU in promoting protected vegetable cultivation?
Yes, sir. Regarding there is a training in the regarding protected vegetable cultivation, and package is also in soil water conservation about the protected vegetable culture is also published.
Question, please. Any more question, please? If there is no question, then I invite Dr. Kuchinder Kaur to present our article on farm business income and net household income of farm households of Punjab, a comparative study of Fatehgarh and Bathinda district. Dr. Kuchinder Kaur, please.
Yes, sir. Please give me a moment.
No issue in that. You can take your time and...
Yeah. I hope it's visible.
Okay, continue, please.
Yes. Yes. Professors, teachers, researchers, and dear participants, very good morning to all of you. It's a great privilege for me to present my paper here. I have chosen the subtheme changing rural scenario and doubling farmers' income, and I am going to present my paper on. Just a minute, there is a problem with going to the second step. Just a minute. Yeah. So I'm going to present my paper on farm business income and net household income of the farmer household, which is a comparative study of two districts of the state. After showing a remarkable performance during the Green Revolution, Punjab economy has entered into a new era of agrarian distress, where farmers are seen struggling for their survival. A big mismatch between the cost and returns has made agriculture a very unprofitable and unattractive profession. Rural consumption is falling, farm income is not enough and to carry out the investment and to pay the current liabilities. So the situation demands serious rethinking for the revival. We know about the agriculture economy. It's known for its excellent performance during the Green Revolution period. new era of mass starvation, but unfortunately sustained the momentum of its slow. And is it that an economy which was growing at a very much faster rate than the national level is now growing at 0.43% compared to that of the national level of 0.05. Agriculture income to the total state income has also gone down to 13.04%. Literature shows that there is crisis, and the crisis started showing up during 1980s. When there was stagnation of yield, cost started increasing, poverty also increased. In 90s, the state lost its top position, per hectare rate of return declined. Income of the farmer from wheat paddy rotation also started declining, and the farm family income grew at just 1% in 1990s, and while real investment has increased, indicating that there was stagnation in the gains from the Green Revolution. There is a common consensus among the researchers about the crisis, but they differs and they are divided upon the cause of crisis. A few are saying that traditional mixtures and rotation of crops are responsible for these that were replaced by monoculture, which is responsible for several problems and created several imbalances. Generic irrationality of the peasant for using fertilizer, pesticides, improper cropping. The few study, this is the reason. And according to the others, there is growing internationalism and the fall in the public investment, which was responsible for the plight of the farmers. Recent studies are showing, a very alarming situation. Ranganathan, 2015, used the NSS survey data, and then he found that a farmer household is earning around rupees 18,000 a month, and which is much less than the income which a peon of a government office earned. The state had highest per capita income in India and till 2003, and it now stood at seventh position. My own estimates are showing that extent of indebtedness among farmer household based on the NSS survey has increased from 63% to 70%. And the primary survey is showing that around 85% of the farmers in Punjab are under debt. So income is falling, indebtedness is increasing, the rate of return from cultivation has gone down. So what is happening to the income? The paper is trying to figure it out. So this research paper is based on the findings of the primary survey, which was conducted for the year 16 and 17 under a major research project, which was by Indian Council of the Council in 2019. This is the sample of the survey. We have chosen two districts and then 12 villages and a total of 301 farmers in total. The paper aims to calculate the income realized by a farmer household in two districts. We have compared the farm income and the net household income of these farmers across districts, and in order to see what is causing the differences in the income realized, we have looked at the cropping pattern, crop yield, cost and returns of the farmers. And I have also tried to assess the relative importance of farming and the non-farming resources. Farm business income is calculated by subtracting the paid out cost from the gross value of the farm output. And the paid out costs include all the cost of all the purchase inputs like seeds, fertilizer, pesticide, insecticide, cost of hired labor, machinery, cost on repair and maintenance, diesel cost, hiring charges of irrigation means, land rent, and other miscellaneous costs paid by the farmers. Net household income is the sum of the farm income as well as income from all the other income sources like subsidy, occupation, livestock, wage and salaries, income from non-agricultural implements, remittances, pension received, income from leased out land and implements, etc. We have worked out Gini's coefficient as well as the diversity indexes also. So the key findings are such. When we are comparing Fatehgarh Sahib and Bathinda, though the owned area was higher in Bathinda, the net cultivated area is higher in Fatehgarh Sahib. And it is majorly because majority of the farmers in Bathinda, they are engaged in leasing out, while Fatehgarh Sahib majority farmers are in leasing in. Cropping intensity is equal to 200 in both the district, but higher in Bathinda. This is mainly because the Fatehgarh Sahib farmers, they are engaged in cultivation of sugarcane, which is an annual crop. Cropping pattern is dominated by wheat and paddy, 85% in Bathinda of the GCA gross crop area, and 81% in Bathinda is devoted to wheat and paddy. If we are adding cotton to it, it becomes 93% in Bathinda. For all other crops, the area is not that significant. The index of diversity is showing that the crop diversification is higher in Bathinda. Economics of cultivation. This is a complex site because I have tried to, include almost everything here. If you will look at the yield and compare the yield, yield is higher in Bathinda for majority of the crops and mainly for the wheat and paddy. And for maize also, you can see for potatoes also. So this is how the case is about the yield. Costs are definitely higher in Bathinda, and the main reason of this increase or the higher cost the level of investment they are relying upon in and into the cotton as comparing Fatehgarh Sahib and Bathinda, and when I'm taking, category wise, this maroon shade is for farming, income from farming, and the gray shade is for income for livestock and other non-farming. So for the sheep farm in compared to six small farmers in Fatehgarh Sahib and around 55% in Bathinda. So it means that the non-farm sources are very, very significant for the farmers and much more significant than the farming sources. And then, it is actually helping them to survive during the toughest time. The small farmers are surviving because of these dependence upon these sources. This is index of inequality. So index of inequality is the Lorentz curve. This line of gray line is net household income. In Bathinda, the thicker line is farm business income, and net household income is that's the thinner line, and accordingly the maroon. Have a look at this. Fatehgarh Sahib is having more of inequalities in terms of all the aspect, farm business income, net household income, total output, net cultivated area. But when we are comparing Fatehgarh Sahib and Bathinda, and then we are comparing farm business income and net household income, you will see that inequities in the farm income is higher than that of the net household income. Really helping to reduce the inequities in the net household income. So, summary and conclusion. So, farmers in Fatehgarh Sahib are better off than Bathinda. I think all these things are based on the data. I have already included that. Farming provided 17% lower income to Bathinda farmers compared to that in the Fatehgarh Sahib. Despite obtaining higher yield for majority of the crops, farmers in Bathinda lower returns from farming because of relatively higher burden of cost, especially in case of wheat, paddy, and cotton. The yield realized for almost all the main crops like wheat, paddy, maize, basmati, and potato happens to be higher for Bathinda. They have achieved higher yield of at a comparatively lower expense in case of maize, potatoes, basmati, is also showing their comparative efficiency in these crops. Still, the returns from farming remain lower because of higher cost of cultivation of these main three crops. The farmers' higher extent of crop diversification have shown higher returns from farming in Fatehgarh Sahib. On the contrary, Bathinda farmers have displayed an inverse relationship between crop diversification and farming income. Where lies the explanation? Fatehgarh Sahib yielded higher income to them due to comparative cost advantage, assured procurement, huge investment base, the indulgence in the cultivation of other crops is adding to their, this is not based upon hard nation. These farmers always look for better crop option as the cultivation of cotton has become completely non-remunerative in this region due to huge cost and low yield realization. The cultivation of any additional crop is adding to the existing income, existing cost to the cost of these farmers. Diversifying the cropping pattern is not a luxury in this region, but a pop-up mechanism. For instance, majority of the small farmers in Bathinda have shifted to paddy, and many have divided their cotton area in paddy and cotton because they want to diversify, but because they want to reduce the production risk associated with the cost of cotton. The farm income was the largest contributor of net household income for medium and large farmer. This is not the case with the small farmers. Livestock and other non-farm sources of income play an important role in supplementing the household farmers and to survive during this time such as of failure. So what are the implications? The implication is this, that the dependence upon the higher income, higher inputs, low level of farm investment is actually playing a very, very important role, coupled with the huge cost, pesticide and insecticide cost, and low yield realization in cost of cotton. The cultivation has become non-economical in Bathinda. So this calls for investment, research and development, spread of irrigation cover, and advisory support for allied activities in Bathinda. Thank you.
Thank you very much, madam, for your nice presentation. Any question, please, on query you want to ask, anything you want to contribute, anything you want to add, please.
Yeah, please, if anyone has any question, so I can reply.
I have a small query. Can we achieve the target of doubling income by 2022 as our Prime Minister advocated that we will achieve it?
Just a minute. Can you please repeat it?
Our Prime Minister has given the slogan that the farm income
will
double by 2022.
Mr. Parihar, please.
What are the strategy and how we can achieve it? Do you hear me?
Doubling the farmer's income.
Yes. Farm income. It will be doubled or not? And what we should do if you want to double the income of the farmer by 2022?
By 2022, it's not possible, sir, because the kind of situation we are in and COVID-19, you know, because of that, I don't think that we can achieve it. But, you know, we can definitely make our effort towards that, and I don't think that in real terms it will be we will be able to achieve it even in 2024. By 2024, in the near future, I don't think that we can achieve it, but definitely we need to put our efforts in order to do that. So nominal income, of course, we can, because we are working on MSPs, we are increasing the, you know, the prices, the production prices has increased for the producers also. So in the nominal terms, we can do it by changing the policies. But in the real terms, I don't think that this is going to happen.
I would like to thank all the presenters who made the presentation in the 8th technical session of the 6th national seminar organized jointly by the Department of Economics, Punjabi University Patiala, and the Society of Economics and Development Ludhiana. I would like to thank Dr. Pankaj Kumar, co-chairperson, and Dr. Tarminder Singh, reporter of the 8th technical session. I thank one and all for making this seminar is a success. Thank you very much.